Good morning, everyone. We are so happy that you're here, whether you're in our in-person or online community. Let's open up with a word of prayer this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for bringing us here. Thank you for this gorgeous day that we get to celebrate and worship you. And Lord, I pray that you just use the words and move your Holy Spirit how you want to move him. I pray that you continue to help us to strive to a better life with you, Lord, and come closer to you. And I pray all this in your precious and holy name. Amen. If you're able, please stand and worship with us today.
For you. Jesus. Good morning. It is a powerful name, isn't it? The name of Jesus. Knowing that we can go to Him with any of our concerns, any of our praises, we don't have to go through anybody else. We have a straight line to God through Jesus. A couple prayer requests we have this morning. One is to continue to pray for Ann Hyatt and the Hyatt family on the passing of Russell. Very unexpected for them, so they're having a tough time with that. Keep them in your prayers. Also have a prayer request for Michael Kuhn, who had just finished successful chemo to get rid of colon cancer, but now they've discovered a cancerous tumor attached to his abdominal wall and a cyst on his kidney. And Michael's 33 years old. So keep Michael and his family, obviously, in their prayers for healing for him. Let's go to God in prayer this morning. Father, what a great God you are, that you love us enough that you sent your Son so we would have direct access to you through him. Lord, it's something that we take for granted far too often. Lord, we try to do so many things on our own, knowing that we can come to you with anything that's on our mind and on our heart, and you will hear our prayers. Lord, sometimes we think because you don't answer the way we pray that you haven't heard us. But we know that sometimes your answer is yes, sometimes it's no, and sometimes it's not now. Sometimes you have a far better plan for us than what we're praying for, and we just need to trust in you and trust in your divine plan. Lord, we lift up our country, we lift up our world this morning. Lord, it's in a mess. And until we get our lives and our country back in line with your word and what you've called us to, it's going to continue to be that way. Lord, we think the leaders in Washington will straighten our country out. We know that only you, on your throne on high, will straighten things out. And we know that one day that will happen. Lord, I just pray that we would be ready for when that day comes. Lord, we love you. We give you honor and praise and glory in all things. We pray that our worship this morning will be meaningful to you and will lift your name above all. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
It is our custom as the deacons bring the elements to you that we hold them and we'll all take them together in communion. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 10, Paul tells us that every knee will bow, those in heaven, those on the earth, and those under the earth. And every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. And every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. This is Jesus' table, and he invites you to come. So why would you come to Jesus' table? I have to confess that sometimes I have come here probably like Adam and Eve. I know I've sinned. And to try to cover my sin and my nakedness, I want to sew fig leaves together to cover all that up. God didn't accept fig leaves. It has to be the shedding of blood to wipe away sins. So he introduced the sacrifice of animals, and he sacrificed, God did, sacrifice the first animals for the Old Testament believers so that their sin could be covered. Sometimes I've come to this table thinking, I'm good enough. I go to church. I pay my tithes. I teach Sunday school. I go to Bible studies. I read my Bible. I am good enough. Sometimes when I come to this table, I realize what a sinner I really am. How short I have fallen of God's standards of perfection. Only by his grace, the shed blood of his son, and the bread of a new life, his resurrection life. I would remind you of Philippians 2:10. Everyone will confess that Jesus is Lord. Today, when you come, when you take part of these elements representing Jesus' shed blood and the bread of a new life in Christ, remember the best way to come to this table is in humility, realizing what a sinner I am. And that I have been saved by his grace and his mercy. And today, I will confess that he is my Lord. He is my Lord.
Why?
So when you come to this table today, are you sowing fig leaves, trying to cover your nakedness and your sin? Are you good enough? You don't really need to come to this table. Or are you a sinner saved by grace? And you're confessing today, Jesus is my Lord. It was on the night that Jesus was betrayed that he took the bread and he broke it. And when he had given thanks, Lord, I just thank you for the tremendous day that we have the freedom to be in your house and to be in your very presence because of what your Son has done for us. He has given us a new life, a new resurrection life, a new life in Christ. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. And he took the bread and he says, take and eat. In like manner, he took the cup. And when he had poured it out, he offered it to his disciples. And he says, take and drink and remember me. Remember my shed blood given for you. Acknowledge me today, Jesus, as my Lord. So what can we say about this table except Jesus is my Lord? Thank you, Jesus.
Good morning. Good morning. I am Kim Molden. I am Mike's favorite cousin. And my mom, Denise, and I are here today to worship with y'all, and we're so excited. This is my first time being here since Mike has been pastor. And I'm just blessed to be here. Miss my dad, of course, but on behalf of my mom and I, we want to thank you for your prayers during the time of his passing and also during the time of when I was going through cancer. I know you guys prayed a lot for me, and were holding us up and lifting us up to Jesus, and we just thank you so much for that, because without that, I would not have made it through. Cancer-free or not, it always helps to have the Lord by your side, for sure. I want to share a couple of songs with you this morning. Simply because Mike asked me to, and if he asked me to, I'm going to do it, okay? In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. This one is my favorite verse. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I
stand. On the outside, looking in, lonely was his only constant friend. So when the invitation came that clearly bore his name, he hardly could believe the words he read. There is always a place at the table. Waiting all your own. Your place is set each time the family gathers. It will never be the same until you're home. So many choices that had torn her life apart and hurt the very ones she loved the most. She didn't even know where someone could begin until she got this message from the host. There is always a place at the table. Now waiting all your own. Your place is set each time the family gathers. It will never be the same until you're home.
For those of you who didn't hear, Jamie just said, good luck following that boy. Jamie doesn't know how much I needed that. Should have had Kim sing last. And just to set the record straight, we are favorite cousins. Uncle Bob made the comment one time, said, Kim, you all need to quit saying all that. You're going to make the rest of them mad. And Kim said, well, they know it. We just well say it. That's right. we do get cards and letters from people every once in a while. I want to share one with you this morning. It says, dearest FCC family, Tom and I would like to thank each of you for the welcoming words, hugs, smiles, prayers, and kindness you have given us. Easter Sunday, 20... Told you should have gone last. Easter Sunday, 2022 was a day like no other, particularly for me. I could never express the pure joy of that day. Thank you for being witness and loving me and being joyous with me. I know a lot of us were meeting for the first time. As you probably remember, it snowed the day after Easter. We don't see much snow in Belmont, North Carolina. It was beautiful and amazing and perfect. I was sending snow pictures for a friend in North Carolina, and she sent me this, Isaiah 1:18. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. I find myself saying amazing a lot. God's love is amazing, and now to go and witness to those he puts in my path. Fondly, Tom and Kathy Fisher. And for those of you who weren't here, Kathy was here Easter Sunday, and we baptized her into Christ that Sunday morning. So she just wants to express her gratitude and her thanks, and I'm sure she's watching this morning, so thank you, Kathy. We're going to continue this morning in our study in the book of Acts. We're going to be in Acts 16, starting with verse 16. And I think I gave Kathy only through verse 34, but we're going to go through verse 40 this morning. So when the verses aren't up there, it's my fault, not theirs. Luke writes, one day as we were going down to the place of prayer, we met a slave girl who had a spirit that enabled her to tell the future. She earned a lot of money for her masters by telling fortunes. She followed Paul and the rest of us, shouting, these men are servants of the Most High God, and they have come to tell you how to be saved. This went on day after day until Paul got so exasperated that he turned and said to the demon within her, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And instantly it left her. Her master's hopes of wealth were now shattered, so they grabbed Paul and Silas and dragged them before the authorities at the marketplace. The whole city is in an uproar because of these Jews, they shouted to the city officials. They are teaching customs that are illegal for us Romans to practice. A mob quickly formed against Paul and Silas, and the city officials ordered them stripped and beaten with wooden rods. They were severely beaten, and then they were thrown into prison. The jailer was ordered to make sure they didn't escape. So the jailer put them into the inner dungeon and clamped their feet in the stocks. Around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening. Suddenly, there was a massive earthquake, and the prison was shaken to its foundations. All the doors immediately flew open, and the chains of every prisoner fell off. The jailer woke up to see the prison doors wide open. He assumed the prisoners had escaped, so he drew his sword to kill himself. But Paul shouted to him, stop! Don't kill yourself. We are all here. The jailer called for lights and ran to the dungeon and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them out and asked, sirs, what must I do to be saved? They replied, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, along with everyone in your household. And they shared the word of the Lord with him and with all who lived in his household. Even at that hour of the night, the jailer cared for them and washed their wounds. Then he and everyone in his household were immediately baptized. He brought them into his house and set a meal before them, and he and his entire household rejoiced because they all believed in God. The next morning, the city officials sent the police to tell the jailer, let those men go. So the jailer told Paul, the city officials have said you and Silas are free to leave. Go in peace. But Paul replied, they have publicly beaten us without a trial and put us in prison, and we are Roman citizens. So now they want us to leave secretly? Certainly not. Let them come themselves to release us. When the police reported this, the city officials were alarmed to learn that Paul and Silas were Roman citizens. So they came to the jail and apologized to them. Then they brought them out and begged them to leave the city. When Paul and Silas left the prison, they returned to the home of Lydia. There they met with the believers and encouraged them once more. Then they left town. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word this morning, the power that it has to change our lives and to allow us to live lives for you as our Lord and Savior. Father, just let us hear your word this morning and let us not only hear it, but also to act on it and to draw us closer to you. Do what you've called us to do, to make disciples of all men. Lord, we love you and give you praise at this moment. In Jesus' name, amen. In the 1870s, Old West, a town called Truckee, North California, decided to build a jail. This wasn't just any old jail. This was a wonder to behold. The walls were 32 inches thick at the lower level, and there were no windows unless one counted the small vents for each cell. The ceilings were plate steel, insulated with dirt, and lined with narrow gauge railroad tracks, and all the doors were riveted steel weighing about 200 pounds each. 19 citizens donated $25 each toward construction of the jail, and it was finally built with a price tag of $1,235. Now that was a lot of money for that day, and that was a lot of jail also. But in the Old West, most communities could not afford a jail like that. Many, in fact, got by with a shack that was padlocked or sometimes even a hole in the ground that was secured with bars on top. The tale is also told of an extremely impressive jail from the Old West that no one had ever escaped from. The walls of the jail were quite imposing, but that's all they were. They were built tall and smooth, but they were built very cheaply. The inmates could have knocked a hole in the wall quite easily. And as a result, if any convict had been determined enough to escape, they could have. They just never tried. Had someone decided to escape, those walls could never have held them in the jail. And in the same way, the Bible seems to imply that the apostles rarely met a jail that could hold them. Now, that's not to say that they escaped from every prison that ever held them. It's just that if God didn't want them in jail, there was no jail that could hold them in there. For example, in Acts 12, when we went through that, we were told that King Herod had Peter thrown into prison, but the night before Peter was to be placed on trial, he was asleep, fastened with two chains between two soldiers. Others stood at the prison gate. Others stood guard at the prison gate. Suddenly there was a bright light in the cell, and an angel of the Lord stood before Peter. The angel struck him on the side to awaken him and said, "Quick, get up." And the chains fell off his wrists. Then the angel told him, "Get dressed and put on your sandals," and Peter did. "Now put on your coat and follow me," the angel ordered. So Peter left the cell, following the angel, but all the time he thought it was a vision. He didn't realize that this was actually happening. They passed the first and second guard post and came to the iron gate leading to the city, and this opened for them all by itself. So they passed through and started walking down the street, and then the angel suddenly left him. Now the point is that no prison, no jail, no guard or soldier could ever have held any of the apostles of Christ. So if that's true, why is it that in our text this morning in Acts 16, Paul and Silas have this opportunity to escape, but they don't? The cell doors were open, the shackles had fallen from their feet. All they had to do to gain their freedom was to run for it. Why didn't they? Well, they didn't escape because God wanted them there. Remember a couple weeks ago when Paul and Silas were sent by God to a specific prayer meeting at a specific river for a specific lady named Lydia. In the same way, Paul and Silas were there in Philippi, in that jail, on that night, because God wanted them there. God didn't want them leaving that jail because God wanted them to talk to someone. He wanted them to witness to this jailer and to his family. Now, with that said, I want us to think about who this jailer was. Do you think this jailer was a friend of Paul and Silas? No, no way. He didn't go and visit them in their cell before the earthquake. He didn't go down to their cell to loosen their chains. He didn't go down to their cell to bandage up their wounds or put medicine on their cuts. He didn't go down to talk about Jesus or ask him to pray for him. Paul and Silas were his prisoners, not his friends. And notice what it says. The jailer was ordered to make sure they didn't escape. So the jailer put them into the inner dungeon and clamped their feet in stocks. The jailer was never told to put Paul and Silas inside the inner prison. He was told to make sure they didn't escape. And he wasn't instructed to put their feet in stocks. So why would he do that? Why would he treat them so roughly? Because he doesn't like Paul and Silas. He regards them as criminals. After all, the entire town had condemned these two men. Obviously, they were guilty. When you talk to folks who make visits to prisoners in local jails, one of the themes you consistently hear from them is that the jailers aren't always very nice to the prisoners. Why? Because many of those jailers get cynical over the years. They've heard it all before. And you know what one of the common pleas of prisoners is? I am innocent. I didn't do it. But most of them are guilty. And most of them have done it. So after a while, there are jailers who presume if they're here, they're guilty. And my job is to make sure they don't want to come back. And as far as the jailer in Acts 16 is concerned, Paul and Silas are guilty. In his mind, they deserved what they got, and they deserved to be where they were. And if he can help make them a little more uncomfortable, he's more than happy to oblige. And I'm convinced that Paul and Silas understood all of this. They knew this man had already prejudged them. They knew he didn't think much of them. They knew that if he got his chance, he would probably make their lives as miserable as he possibly could. One of the things that strikes me in this story is how unfair it all seems to be. Paul and Silas were nice men trying to do the will of God. They had faithfully preached the gospel. They'd freed a woman from demon possession. But the men who owned the woman possessed by demons stirred up the crowd, and they had dragged Paul and Silas before the city rulers in the marketplace for a kangaroo court. There in the marketplace, Paul and Silas had their clothes stripped from their bodies. They were beaten unmercifully and unjustly. And then to add insult to injury, they dragged them off to jail, where we're told that the jailer put them in the inner dungeon and clamped their feet in stocks. It just wasn't right. It shouldn't have happened. And the jailer was right there being part of the injustice that they suffered. He was just as mean and just as vindictive as everyone else. He was part of the cause of their misery. Paul and Silas would have every reason to hate him and despise him. But instead, they witnessed to him. Now, there might come a time when you have the opportunity to witness to someone just like that. Hopefully not in jail. But to witness to somebody who doesn't really like you. Someone who doesn't want to be around you. Maybe someone who's hurt you. Perhaps they're mean-spirited and they're harsh. But whatever the reason is, you don't like them and they don't like you. And you would just as soon not witness to them. They're not the kind of people you want in church with you. You don't want to talk to them about Christ because, frankly, they don't deserve Christ. What they deserve is, well, let's just be honest. They deserve to go to hell. But think about that for a minute. Is there someone, anyone that you know that makes you feel that way? Someone you're really not comfortable talking about Jesus with. Someone you don't think deserves to hear about Jesus. Well, consider what would happen if God did the same thing to you and me. Romans 3:23 says, "For everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard." Notice what that says. You, me, we've all sinned against God. We've all done things that have hurt him. We've all said or done or thought things that alienate us from God. Colossians 1:21 says, "This includes you who were once far away from God. You were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions." Before we became Christians, Paul's letter to the Colossians says that you and I were God's enemies. Ephesians 2 verses 1 and 3 goes even farther and says it this way: "Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. You used to live in sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. He is the Spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger, just like everyone else. We were subject to God's anger. In other words, if you and I got what we deserved, we would all be going to hell. But God so loved the world, you, me, everyone else, He gave His only begotten Son. And what happened to that only begotten Son? He was crucified. God paid a terrible price so that you and I could move out of the camp of enemies and being subject to anger and move into the family of God, becoming His friends and family. But at one point, we were enemies. We were subjects of God's anger. And Paul knew this because he had been an enemy of Jesus. It was Paul who had been part of the death of Stephen, the first Christian martyr to die for his faith. Paul is thought to have even been one of the ringleaders of that crowd, holding the cloaks of those who threw stones at Stephen's defenseless body until he died. But Paul was just getting started. For some time after that, Paul persecuted the church. He was going everywhere to destroy the church. He went from house to house, dragging out both men and women to throw them into prison. Just like this jailer had thrown Paul into this jail. And yet God had saved Paul. Now it was Paul's chance to repay God's kindness to him and to witness to this jailer, to offer to this man the salvation that God had so freely given to him. And if we're given an opportunity to witness to people who've not been nice to us, it becomes our chance to repay God for His kindness in saving us as well. It's our opportunity to show God that we get it, to show God that we understand that Jesus died for all mankind, even the ones we don't like. And in that action, we can bring honor to our God. Paul repaid God by witnessing to someone who did not like him and mistreated him. And if we want to follow in Paul's footsteps in this, how can we accomplish this? How can we follow in Paul's footsteps when the person we're trying to witness to doesn't particularly like us? Well, first, we need to make it obvious who we belong to. Paul and Silas were beaten, thrown into an inner prison, and fastened in stocks. But about midnight, what do they end up doing? Around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening. Paul and Silas were worshiping God right in the jail, and everybody heard them. Everybody in that jail knew that Paul and Silas belonged to Jesus because even in jail, they worshiped Him. And when we think of worshiping, we think of the things we do here on Sunday mornings. And so when we think worship, we think church building. But the early church didn't have church buildings. They didn't have stained glass and pulpits and keyboards and screens. They didn't have glass doors and heat and air conditioning. And so when they worshiped everywhere, mostly in homes, sometimes out in the public square, sometimes down at the riverside, but occasionally even in prison. And when they worshiped, they witnessed. People saw how much Jesus meant to them. Every act of worship should be viewed as a witnessing tool. Singing, praying, studying our Bibles. For example, when Paul wrote to the Corinthian church, he told them, every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, every time you take communion, you're announcing the Lord's death until He comes. Every time we gather here and take communion, and a visitor comes in to join us, we declare to that visitor that we believe that Jesus Christ died for our sins. Every Sunday we declare that, and we witness to Christ's faithfulness on the cross. So it's worth realizing that we need to proclaim God outside these walls. We need to be obvious. We need to be bold, to be unashamed, to be unapologetic. A woman told of taking her children out to a restaurant, and her six-year-old son asked if he could say grace, and he prayed this prayer. God is good, God is great. Thank You for the food, and I would even thank You more if Mom gets us ice cream for dessert. and liberty and justice for all. Amen. There was a lot of laughter from other customers, but a nearby woman remarked, "That's what's wrong with this country. Kids today don't even know how to pray, asking God for ice cream. Why, I never." The little boy heard this and he burst into tears and he asked his mother, "Did I do it wrong? Is God mad at me?" And his mom held him and assured him that he had done a terrific job. An elderly gentleman approached the table. He winked at the boy and said, "I happen to know that God thought that was a great prayer." The boy brightened up and he asked, "Really?" "Cross my heart," the man replied. Then in a theatrical whisper, indicating the woman whose remark had started the whole thing, he added, "Too bad she never asked God for ice cream. A little ice cream is good for the soul sometimes." So naturally, the mother bought the kids ice cream at the end of the meal. And her son stared at his for a moment, and he picked up his sundae and without a word, walked over and placed it in front of the woman who had scolded him. With a big smile, he told her, "Here, this is for you. Ice cream is good for the soul sometimes. And my soul is good already." Now that little boy proclaimed God. He worshiped God in his prayer, and in his worship, he witnessed. Many of you have probably seen the post that makes its round on social media, "I believe churches are meant for praising God, but so are 2 a.m. car rides, showers, coffee shops, the gym, conversations with friends and strangers. Don't let a building confine your faith, because we will never change the world by just going to church. We need to be the church. We need to realize that worship is not something we do just here in this building. Worship is something that we must learn to do beyond these walls, because when we worship, we witness." So the first thing that Paul and Silas did was they made it obvious who they belonged to. Everybody in that prison knew they loved Jesus and they belonged to him. And the next thing they did was to make it obvious that they cared for the jailer. Someone once said, "People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care." When the earthquake shook that jail, it shook the jailer's world as well. When he woke up, he saw that all the prison doors are open, and he was convinced that his life is over. If the prisoners escaped, he would pay with his life. So he decided to avoid the horror of execution by taking his own life. Paul sees this, and he could have let the jailer take his own life. I mean, why should Paul be concerned? The jailer had hurt them physically. The jailer had been mean to them and hurt them emotionally. Paul didn't owe this guy anything. Why should Paul care? But Paul did care. And he shouts out, "Don't kill yourself, we're all here." Paul knows why this man is afraid. And he knows his life is in the balance. And knowing that, Paul reaches out to the jailer. And we need to watch for that kind of opportunity to share Jesus. It helps to realize that this is the kind of person the rest of the world turns its back on. The world tends to look for the companionship of those who are successful, those who have it all together, those who are attractive, those who are connected. But when a person's life is falling apart, the rest of the world often turns its back. Jesus has taught us to reach out to the hurting and the wounded, to reach out when they've lost their job, when they've lost their marriage, when they've lost their home, to reach out when they've lost a loved one. These are the times when people need the message of hope from Jesus Christ. And that's why it's so critical that Christians step up when people are down. Sometimes when we reach out and do all the right things, we realize the person we're trying to reach out to isn't budging. They refuse to be interested in Christ. And notice in our text this morning that Paul and Silas didn't seek this man out. The jailer sought them. The jailer asked Paul and Silas, "What must I do to be saved?" And the jailer sought them out because God was working behind the scenes to soften his heart. Think about the whole picture. The jail is shaken by an earthquake that opened the prison doors and loosed the shackles of all the prisoners at exactly the moment that everyone is paying attention to Paul and Silas worshiping God. Do you really think that was a coincidence? I don't think so. I think that was a God incidence. It shouldn't take a genius to connect the dots and associate the God of Paul and Silas with the earthquake that shook their world. But that doesn't entirely explain the sudden interest in this jailer's salvation. Why would he so suddenly ask what he must do to be saved? Because God was at work softening his heart for just that moment. Jesus said, "I will send the Holy Spirit to you, and when he comes, he will convict the world of its sin and of God's righteousness and of the coming judgment." You see, the Holy Spirit's job is to convince men of their sin, to convince them of their need for righteousness, to convince them of the fact that there is a coming judgment. And when we witness to people about Christ, it's not all about us. God is at work behind the scenes, convincing them of their need for salvation. He prepares the hearts of those who we can witness to. And if we're paying attention, we can find God at work and reach out to those who need and are looking out for Jesus. So what do we tell people who ask, "What must I do to be saved?" We tell them the same thing Paul did. Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, along with everyone in your household. That's what Paul and Silas told the jailer. And they shared the word of the Lord with him and with all who lived in his household. Paul and Silas went home with the jailer and explained to him and his family what it meant to believe in Jesus Christ and to be saved. They would have taught this jailer and his family that they need to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. They would have taught them that they need to believe that they were sinners and that only Jesus could remove that sin. They would have taught them that they need to believe that Jesus has to be the master and Lord of their lives. And they would have taught them that they need to be buried with Jesus in the waters of baptism. Even at that hour of the night, the jailer cared for Paul and Silas and washed their wounds. Then he and everyone in his household were immediately baptized. But before you can tell people about Jesus, especially someone who doesn't like you, you need to know those two things. You need to be obvious about who you belong to, and you need to make it obvious that you care for them as individuals. A young factory worker noticed one day that a valuable tool was missing from his toolbox. And later he recognized it in the toolbox of a fellow employee. The young man was the only Christian in the shop, and he wanted to have a good testimony for Christ. So he went home and prayed about the matter. The next day he went to the man and he said, "I see you have one of my tools, but you can keep it if you need it." Then he went on with his work and put the incident out of his mind. During the next 2 weeks, the person who had taken the tool tried to soothe his own conscience. First, he offered the young man something of equal value. Then he offered to help him on some home projects. And finally, he slipped some money into his coat pocket. Ultimately, they became friends, and the one-time tool thief started coming to church with his new Christian friend and eventually made the decision to become a Christian. All because of a Christian factory worker who was willing to make it obvious he trusted God and he showed that he cared. What would you do in that same situation? Every day, our actions in difficult circumstances show who we belong to and what our priorities are. Every day, our actions show who we care for. When we belong to Christ and His kingdom, we care about the eternity of others over our temporary rights and our comfort in this life. If you don't belong to Christ, we want to give you the opportunity this morning to make Him your Savior and Lord, to admit your sin to Him and repent of that sin, to publicly confess Jesus Christ as the Son of the living God, humbly submitting to the waters of baptism and be raised to a new life in Him, and live with Jesus Christ as the Lord of your life. If you already belong to Jesus and want to make First Christian Church your new church home, we offer that invitation this morning as well. Let's pray. Father in heaven, your word always challenges us and convicts us. And Lord, it's up to us to respond to that through the leading of your Holy Spirit. Lord, if there's one here this morning who needs to know you as Lord and Savior of their life, we pray that today would be the day that they would come forward and make that decision to confess of their sins, repent of those sins, to name you as Lord of their life, to submit to the waters of baptism, and to live a life of service and faithfulness to you. Lord, if there's one here today who's already made that decision and wants to make First Christian Church their church home, to join us as part of your family in living in obedience and service to you, we welcome that decision as well. Lord, we just love you and praise you and give you glory in all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you all for coming this morning. Thank you to Sarah for filling in for Karen and Lindsay. Thank you, Kim, always. Thank you, Fran, Denise, being here as well. Hope you all have a great week. Several things on the announcements. I want to point out, especially there's a prayer group that meets at 6:30 a.m. on Tuesday mornings now. Also, we're having our Men's Beast Feast Wildlife Supper this Friday, 6 o'clock. Either bring a wildlife dish or a side dish. And bring a friend. We haven't been advertising on Facebook or anything like that, but please bring some friends with you. Love to have them. Love to have a lot of people here that day. Evidently, Andrew has something to say as well.
I always got something to say. So just a few things coming up. We actually, back on our children's church table, there is little postcards that are invites for our Vacation Bible School this year. It has all the information, and the QR code on that goes straight to our Facebook page, which will have pre-registration on it and whatnot. So if you take a couple of those, give them out to your friends, people who have kids that week, we are super excited for. We do and may need a few extra volunteers, so if you would like to volunteer that week as well, just come see me. I'm going to be back here with the kids. Just come and be like, hey, I want to volunteer, and I'll be like, okay, I'll get you down. I can get you down anywhere. So, and you might have to be careful, because I might say, hey, Sunday mornings, we also have this, but that's a whole other thing. Also, next Sunday, May 22nd, we are going to have our first Nine Square in the Park. I don't know if it's going to be up behind me or not. Last week I was like holding up my sheet of paper and then it was up behind me. So it's going to be our first Nine Square in the Park. That is not just for young families. That is for everybody in the church. You know, we've been talking about discipleship. We've been talking about going out and meeting others and talking to other people. this is a perfect opportunity. We're going to be in the park. I'm going to take Nine Square, bring other yard games, bring a picnic lunch, whatever you would like to bring, and we're just going to be there for like an hour or two, somewhere in there. It might depend on how wild Nine Square gets, but we'll have Nine Square in the park at the Familyland area and at Jim Barnett. So at 1 p.m., please, like, please come, and we're going to have lots of fun. It'll be a good time to bond and get together outside of these four walls. So that's all I have. Thank you so much.
Okay. One other quick announcement. Anyone interested in participating in the visitation ministry? I see Darlene. Y'all going to meet in here? Okay, they're going to meet in the sanctuary as soon as the service is over. They want to start doing some visiting with some of our homebound folks and things like that. It'll be a great opportunity to get out and have some good time and bring some joy to some people. All right, so let's pray. Father, we just thank you for your goodness to us, your faithfulness to us, and your many blessings you give us each day. Lord, we thank you for all that you've already done for us. Lord, we just pray that you would give us opportunities this week to share the good news of salvation through your Son with those that we come in contact with this week. Lord, give us boldness and give us grace. And let us do all things for your glory and for your honor. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.